Hello friends and welcome to StudyIQ. I'm Joycey Joy. Today we will be discussing about the significance of cross-border insolvency. Let us see what is cross-border insolvency. So after that we will go on to the current affair. So cross-border insolvency means regulation of the treatment of financially distressed debtors where the debtors have assets or creditors in more than one country. For example, a debtor. If a person who has taken loan or credit from more than one country and if that person has assets in more than one country, it is called cross-border insolvency. So basically the cross-border insolvency is concerned about those companies or those individuals who have businesses or assets in more than one country. So this is cross-border insolvency. So today we will be discussing about the significance of cross-border insolvency. Now, let us first come to the current affair. Let us see what is the current affair. The IBC, that is the Insolvency and the Bankruptcy Code, has faced grave implementation challenges in the recent times. So, in recent times, the IBC implementation, the implementation of the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code has faced various challenges. So, we will be discussing about these challenges in detail. So, this is the current affair. Now, coming to IBC, let us have an overview about the IBC or the Insolvency and the Bankruptcy Code. So, the Insolvency and the Bankruptcy Code was adopted in 2016. So, this code that was adopted in 2016, it consolidates the existing framework by creating a single law for insolvency and bankruptcy. So, the IBC of 2016 tries to consolidate, it tries to bring together all the existing framework or existing laws regarding insolvency and bankruptcy into a single law for insolvency and bankruptcy in India. And when a default in the repayment occurs, when there is a default in the repayment of the loans, the creditors can gain control over the assets of the debtors. So, this is what the IBC talks about. Now, for example, a bank, SBI, has given a credit to a company or an individual of rupees 10 crore. So, if the payment, the repayment of this credit given by SBI, if there is any default made by the individual or the company, then the SBI is here the creditor and the individual who has borrowed the money is the debtor. So, the creditor can have control over the assets of the debtor. So, this is what the IBC talks about. And the creditor, that is in our case the SBI, the creditor must make decisions to resolve insolvency within 180 days period. So, this is the condition under the IBC or the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. Now, in order to ensure an uninterrupted resolution process, the IBC, the Insolvency and the Bankruptcy Code provides immunity to the debtors from resolution claims of creditors during this period. So, in order to make sure that the process of resolution is not interrupted, the code, the IBC provides for immunity to the debtors from various resolution claims of creditors during the period of the resolution. And next one, the IBC, the Insolvency and the Bankruptcy Code, it also consolidates, that is, it brings together the provisions of the current legislative framework in order to form a common forum for the debtors and creditors of all classes to resolve the insolvency. That is, existing provisions, that already there are certain provisions or current legislative frameworks available. So, the IBC consolidates all the provisions in the current legislative frameworks in order to bring in or in order to make a common forum for the debtors and the creditors of all classes in order to resolve insolvency. So, basically, it has consolidated the existing provisions and existing rules and laws. So, now let us come to those authorities or various authorities under the IBC or Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. First one is IP. IP is Insolvency Professionals. So, the first one is Insolvency Professionals. Now, second one is IPA. IPA is Insolvency Professional Agencies. So these are the various authorities under the IBC. Now third one is the adjudicating authorities. The adjudicating authorities are NCLT, National Company Law Tribunal in case of corporates, and DRT, that is a Debt Recovery Tribunal in case of individuals. So in case of individuals, we have Debt Recovery Tribunal, and in case of corporates or in case of companies, we have the National Company Law Tribunal. So these are the adjudicating authorities. So these are the authorities that will facilitate the insolvency resolution or the insolvency process under this code of IBC. So these are the authorities, very important. The authorities and their mandate is very important. Now let us see what are the implementation challenges involved in IBC. So what are the challenges in the proper or effective implementation of the insolvency and bankruptcy code? So first one, it was widely expected that the IBC will enact the cross-border insolvency provisions very soon. So IBC was implemented or enacted in the year 2016. And when IBC was enacted, it was believed that the cross-border insolvency provisions would also be enacted soon. But from 2016 till now, that is till 2019, the issue of the cross-border insolvency has not been addressed by the IBC till now. So this is the biggest challenge. So since the formation or the enactment of insolvency and bankruptcy code, the expectation was that it will soon come up with provisions to deal with cross-border insolvency, which did not happen. And many of the larger cases going on in the IBC, so many large cases undergoing insolvency, for example the case of Amtek Auto, Videocon, Esser Steel, the Jet Airways, so these are all certain cases which are undergoing insolvency. So these are very complicated, these are very complex because of cross-border issues, and IBC has not addressed this issue of cross-border insolvency. So the biggest challenge in the implementation of IBC is that there is an absence of framework to deal with cross-border insolvency, and this absence of framework to deal with the cross-border insolvency is likely to result in significant loss in the value of assets of such companies. And here the biggest concern is that the government has also not shown much urgency to enact a law inside the IBC to deal with cross-border insolvency. Now, the IBC mandates the insolvency, but most of the cases of insolvency are pending within the IBC because there are no provisions to deal with the cross-border insolvency. So this is the biggest implementation challenge with regard to cross-border insolvency. Now let us see what are the measures that has been taken on cross-border insolvency. So we will see that there is an absence of framework or absence of provisions within the IBC to deal with the cross-border insolvency. So in this gap, the judiciary had to step in order to plug in the gap in the cross-border insolvency, and this judicial involvement happened in case of Jet Airways insolvency. So while dealing with the insolvency case of the Jet Airways, the judiciary had stepped in order to take some measures regarding cross-border insolvency. So in the month of May 2019, a Dutch court, passed an order of insolvency of Jet Airways on a petition of creditors based in Netherlands, and the court, Dutch court, appointed a trustee. So this is what happened. I'll explain to you in brief what happened. So in the month of May, the Dutch court passed an order for the insolvency of Jet Airways, and this court order was based on the petition given by the creditors. The creditors were based in Netherlands, and the court appointed a trustee. And the Jet Airways has its regional hub in Schiphol Airport in Netherlands, and following this, the NCLT directed the interim resolution professional to ignore the order of the Dutch court and the trustee. And after recognizing the threat, ignoring the Dutch court and the trustee, the threat it will pose towards sustainable insolvency resolution outcome of the Jet Airways, the NCLAT, that is the appellate tribunal, National Companies Law's Appellate Tribunal advised exploration of a framework of cooperation. So, the Appellate Tribunal asked for a framework of cooperation. And after extensive negotiations, a cross-border insolvency protocol was agreed upon. So, a cross-border insolvency protocol was agreed after this. And now coming to the cross-border insolvency protocol, this protocol was based on the principles on the UNCITRAL. Now, UNCITRAL or UNCITRAL, it is United Nations Commission on International Trade Law. And the headquarters of UNCITRAL, it's in Vienna in Austria. And it was founded in the year 1966. So, based on the principles of the UNCITRAL cross-border insolvency model law, the protocol was designed. And the protocol provides a framework of international coordination, at the same time respecting the independent jurisdiction, sovereignty and authority of the NCLT, National Company Law Tribunal, or the Appellate Tribunal, and also the Dutch Court. So, the protocol, that is a cross-border insolvency protocol, it recognized that the Jet Airways, it was an Indian company with its center of main interest in India. The IBC proceedings are the main insolvency proceedings, and the Dutch proceedings are the non-main insolvency proceedings. So, it recognized that the Jet Airways, which is an Indian company and had its main economic interest in India. So, it agreed that the proceedings under the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, the IBC in India, should be the principal proceeding against the Jet Airways, against the insolvency proceedings against the Jet Airways. Now, the protocol regarding the cross-border insolvency protocol, the protocol seeks to promote international cooperation and coordination. So, the cooperation, the international cooperation and coordination should be ensured in certain things. For example, to provide for orderly and timely administration in order to reduce the cost. Second one, to promote communication among the parties and the committee of the creditors. Third one, to enhance or facilitate communication among the NCLT, the Appellate Tribunal, that is the NCLAT, and also the Dutch Court. Fourth one is to provide for sharing of information and data among the parties in order to avoid duplication of effort and activities. Fifth one is to identify, preserve and maximize the value of the Jet Airways worldwide assets. This is the most important one. So, to maximize the value of the Jet Airways worldwide assets. So, when the value is maximum, the benefits are also maximum for everyone. And this protocol was approved by the NCLAT, the National Company Law's Appellate Tribunal, in the month of September. And this is viewed as a historical development by the international community, and this is a signal that the insolvency market in India is maturing. So these are the measures that has been adopted on cross-border insolvency as of now. And now, what is the way ahead? What has to be done? Now, we have seen that the protocol, this protocol has narrowed the gap between the cross-border insolvency provisions available and what is needed. So this gap has been definitely narrowed down. But what we need is a comprehensive cross-border insolvency law. So, this protocol is specifically applicable to the case of Jet Airways. But what we need is a comprehensive cross-border insolvency law. Within our IBC, we should include the provisions for dealing with cross-border insolvency as well. And most of the sophisticated economies have well-developed cross-border insolvency laws, and India should also have one. And regarding the adoption of UNCITRAL, UNCITRAL model law, it is a necessity, it is not an option. So, it is a necessity. So, the comprehensive law should adopt the model law that is already framed by the UNCITRAL. So, it should include the provisions as in the model law provided by UNCITRAL. So, this is what we need, and in order to pave way for an effective insolvency proceeding in India, we really need to adopt cross-border insolvency provisions as well. You can find the PDF of this lecture on our website www.studyiq.com. You can follow my Facebook page for more video updates. You can write to me at joycy.studyiq@gmail.com for any of your queries and clarification. Thank you.